Good morning, or I should say good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to have everyone join us for our third in our series of Everything Parkinson's webinars from the Pacific Movement Disorders Center at Pacific Neuroscience Institute. Today I have the pleasure to introduce somebody which I believe many of you are already familiar with. Giselle Tamula, our hardworking, trusty, always optimistic, always smiling nurse practitioner. And she joined us in 2017. But prior to that, she's been a nurse for almost 20 years, including 10 years of which she spent in the ICU at St. John's. She also runs our Parkinson's disease support group, Life in Motion, as well as our PRESS and PD 101 programs for newly diagnosed Parkinson's patients. So without further ado, Giselle's going to be joining us to talk about how people with Parkinson's can use lifestyle choices to improve their quality of life.
Thank you, Dr. Petrossian. Welcome everyone to our third month of Everything Parkinson. You can hear me, right? You can hear me. Okay. So this is our third month for Everything Parkinson. In the last few months, you have heard us talk about, Dr. Diaz did talk about, like really the basics of Parkinson's, where what is Parkinson's, what are the signs and symptoms of Parkinson's. And then last month, you have learned more about like the treatments that are available for the motor symptoms of Parkinson's. So here we're going to talk about today about treating Parkinson's with lifestyle choices. So as Dr. Petrossian mentioned, I am her nurse practitioner here at the Pacific Movement Disorder Center. I have been with Dr. Petrossian for a few years too. And this is really one of our favorite topics here at the Brain Health and the Movement Disorder Center. This really puts you at the driver's seat on this are really things that you can do to optimize brain health and brain function as you go through your journey with Parkinson. So this is particularly important, like I said, because this puts you on the driver's seat to doing that. And this can really change the outcomes of your Parkinson's disease as you move along the way. So I'm going to start with a famous quote from a very famous face with Parkinson's disease. This is from Michael J. Fox. I don't have any choice whether or not I have Parkinson's, but surrounding that non-choice is a million other choices I can make. I really started with this quote because I think my talk today really sums this up very beautifully. While we cannot choose that to get Parkinson's, but there are so many things really that you can do to optimize your health. So here at the Pacific Brain Health Center, we have summed up this recommendation in an acronym called SHIELD, which stands for sleep, handle stress, interact with others, exercise, learn new things, and diet. So we're going to go through each of these recommendations, and hopefully you're going to integrate some of these practices to enhance things that you already might be doing and improve them. So we'll start with sleep. I think we can all agree how important sleep is. A good quality and quantity of sleep, the number of hours, can really affect how we function in our day-to-day activities. It really can improve our health and well-being. We are so much more patient and maybe kinder to the people around us when we've had a good night's rest. We also know that good sleep can reduce stress. It can induce the risk of heart disease, diabetes, and really a myriad of other illnesses, cognitive impairments, Alzheimer's disease. It can really diminish fogginess in the brain the next day if we do not have good sleep. This also improves your memory and mood. So what happens with sleep is that it replenishes the neurotransmitter such as dopamine, which is really important with people with Parkinson's disease where it is diminished. So it clears out toxin buildup in the brain. So if we do go to sleep and we do have good sleep, what usually happens is that there is our brain cells actually shrink a little bit, and there are, and it releases this toxin buildup from our day. So it's sort of like a car wash, so to speak, for our brain. So this tells us how important sleep really is. So what are the common problems we see with Parkinson's disease? One of the more common ones is really insomnia. Insomnia is the condition where we are unable to sleep. And with usually with, or not just a problem falling asleep, but sometimes it could be that you are able to fall asleep immediately, but it is the staying asleep that can be an issue. So this can be a couple of things. Some people with Parkinson's do have a lot of stiffness and rigidity. So sometimes turning in bed can be really challenging, and this discomfort can result in people being unable to sleep or having really bad sleep. Another thing, that could happen is also anxiety. Anxiety is one of those conditions where sometimes it can just go into a loop, and that is going to be really challenging. Sometimes we are unable to sleep because we're thinking so many things and it's just making us anxious. And sometimes just being anxious that you're not able to fall asleep will make you more anxious, which just spirals down. So that keeps people awake at night and having really resulting in a really bad sleep pattern. Sometimes too, it could be that we are urinating a lot at night. So we have this, we need to go to the bathroom 3-5 times a night. And this is very disruptive to your sleep pattern. Another condition that we also see that is associated with Parkinson's disease is what we call REM sleep behavior disorder, or RBD. This occurs when someone acts out dreams. They have vivid dreams. Usually it might even be your sleep partner or your spouse that will tell you that you do have this disorder. So what usually happens with sleep is that when we are asleep, our brain is supposed to, we are supposed to be paralyzed, where we are really not moving. And it is only really our eyes, hence the rapid eye movement. It's just really our eyes that is going to be moving while the rest of us is really immobile. But what happens with REM sleep is that people are either kicking, punching, screaming, and sometimes even we have patients that report sleepwalking as well. So this can occur. At times, people report that even decades or prior to the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. So these are the common disorders that we see associated with sleep. So what do we do? We need to really establish good sleep hygiene. Our recommendation around this is really to have a consistent sleep schedule. And this does not mean just your Monday to Friday sleep schedule, but try to keep that schedule even on the weekend or when you go on vacation. So try to keep on that schedule. Plan for at the very least 7 hours a day. So let's say you plan to wake up at 6 in the morning. Try to sleep around 7 and maybe start your bedtime routine a little earlier than that. Maybe start around 8:30, 9 o'clock at night. Already establish a bedtime routine so your brain knows, okay, this is now time to winding down. It's time for my brain to shut down. Another is avoid naps longer than 30 minutes. we actually recommend about 15 to 30 minutes during the day, and try to make this earlier in the day. Try to avoid naps later on the day, as this can really disrupt your sleep at night. Once you're in bed, try not to, if you are unable to fall asleep immediately and you find yourself just laying there, get up after 20 minutes. If you still haven't slept, try to get up, go to a room, maybe in your, if you have another room, or maybe your living room, but get out of bed. It would be recommended to read a dull book. Don't read something that's very interesting to you that you're just going to be staying up late finishing your book. So try something really boring, a magazine that you're not very interested about. And then when you feel like you're slowly getting ready to go back to bed, you can go back to bed. Avoid eating 3 hours before bedtime. It is good to be able to sleep with your tummy empty. That just because your digestion is going to be focused there. There's going to be a lot of blood supply there. So it's good to be able to digest first before going to sleep. Avoid caffeine at least 8 hours prior to sleep. So caffeine is interesting because caffeine has a really long half-life. So if you plan to sleep, let's say around 10 o'clock at night, you should plan to not drink any more caffeine or caffeinated beverages like coffee, caffeinated tea, at least at 2 o'clock, after 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So after 2 o'clock, try to avoid caffeine so that you can be able to sleep better if you plan to sleep around 10 o'clock at night. Try to avoid alcohol around bedtime. This is really interesting because a lot of people will say, oh, but alcohol helps me sleep. But a lot of times, alcohol doesn't really give you that deeper sleep. So try to avoid alcohol at least 2 hours before bedtime. Also avoid consuming a lot of fluids prior to bedtime. You know, we do recommend you take drinking fluids during the day. It's really important that you're hydrated. However, if you drink a lot of fluids towards the end of the day, it is going to likely wake you up during the night to go to the bathroom. So it will be better for you. It will be of benefit to you to just reduce your fluid intake at night. And complete an aerobic exercise at least 3 hours before bedtime. So aerobic exercise are pretty active. This really stimulates you and wakes you up. So we try to tell patients to avoid aerobic exercises. However, there are exercises that can actually help. There are like this, yoga can be, there are yoga for bedtime that can actually be slower and can help you relax and thereby help you sleep. So that you can do at night. So what you should avoid is really the aerobic exercises. Like if you're going for a jog or a brisk walk, try to do it a little earlier, at least 3 hours prior to bedtime. So what do you do to for your sleep hygiene? It's really recommended to keep your bedroom quiet and a relaxing place for you. So we do recommend not turning on television. If you have a television outside, inside your room, it's really preferable not to have a TV inside your room. But that's not just limited to TV. We do recommend keeping your gadgets also low. So no screen time at least 2 hours prior to bedtime. This is going to be a little challenging for probably most of us who is somehow connected to our phones. But it is really that light stimulation that can wake us up, especially if it is something that we do chronically. So we do recommend if you do have blinds or blackout curtains, this keeps your room dark. If you have a bright room, you also can wear a mask. This is going to be good for you too, because there's really it covers your eyes and therefore there's really limited light that can come in. For those of you that are saying, oh, but I wake up in the middle of the night and I'm really scared of falling because if I don't see anything, we do recommend this motion detector lights. This, when you wake up and it detects any movement, then it will turn on. This can help you versus turning on your bigger lights, which will enhance and probably wake you up, and it will be a little more challenging to go back to sleep. We also recommend to be outdoors when you wake up in the morning, to look outside either by the window or if you have like a patio and you can walk outside, to just also spend time outside for some sunlight. This can really help wake you up in the morning too. So the importance of this, we talk about light so much, and this is important because our eyes are not just for vision. So the other function of our eyes really is that it does have this photoreceptors where it sends a signal to our brain that is connected to our circadian rhythm. So this is why keeping the lights low in your room will tell your brain, will signal your brain that this is already time to sleep. And this is also why we really do not recommend you, if you wake up in the middle of the night, to grab your phone and look at your phone, because just the light from your phone will signal your brain that you're already awake. So this may keep you awake as well. So keep your phones in a separate room if you can. This may be a little challenging. I can already see the protests on this one. So you can keep it on your bedside, but please do not take up your phone and look at it in the middle of the night. Doing it one time is, you know, it won't make so much difference. But however, if this becomes a pattern that you do, then this can be really disruptive for your brain. Okay. So what do we do if we do have insomnia? So one of the things that we can do is do cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. So this is usually done by an occupational therapist. So when we work with a therapist, they usually focus on exploring connections between the way we think, the things that we do, and how we sleep. So the therapist helps us identify our thoughts, our behaviors, and feelings that are contributing to the insomnia. So we usually recommend you going for CBT therapy for insomnia. Another thing you can do is try to read on, there are really numerous books on sleep. A good one is Say Goodbye to Insomnia by Greg Jacobs. Another one is an insomnia workbook by Stephanie Silberman. There are also numerous apps that can be helpful. One of them is Calm. Another one that we recommend here at Brain Health too is Insight Timer is another one. Another one you can also try is Headspace. They do have sleep stories there that you can try. They even have like a sleep radio. So this, it's very calming. So it will really help you sleep as well. So those are apps that you can try. You also can see a urologist to manage your urinary symptoms. Without medications, try to reduce your fluid intake, as I mentioned earlier, but it is also good to also check with a urologist for just any structural issues that can be contributing to this as well. So potentially you can use melatonin. We really do not recommend you taking sedatives such as Ambien is one that's fairly common. We would rather that you work with something that you already have in your body. So melatonin is a good thing. This also helps with RBDs, or the REM sleep behavior disorder. A lot of the patients are really helped just by taking melatonin. There are also other supplements that you can try, but melatonin is really a good one. If you've tried melatonin and maybe you're saying, oh yeah, but my problem is really not the falling asleep part, it's more the staying asleep. Melatonin also works with that. However, you may have to ask your pharmacy pharmacist or call them, because there is another melatonin. It is the long-acting form of melatonin that will help you to stay asleep. But the one that you, this is just an over-the-counter medication. However, you may have to ask if they have the long-acting form, as that can be the one that is going to be helpful for you. So another part of the recommendation is to really handle stress. So stress is really how our body and brain responds to any demand. So stress has really gotten a really bad rap over the years, but it's really, we really cannot escape stress. We experience stress every day, and it's not necessarily just on negative events. Stress can also include positive events in our lives, such as weddings. We recently just had a big holiday during Christmas, or the holiday, the New Year. There are a lot of festivities that can really cause people a lot of stress too. And just the planning of that can cause sleepless nights with some people too. Another positive event that can also be stressful is having a baby, an addition to the family. So we really cannot avoid stress. And it's really important that to note also that stress can be used to help propel us to do so many things that are actually good for us. For example, a lot of people really thrive using stress as a propeller to do good things. If you are working, if you have like a project at work, it is really the stress of accomplishing this task that can, that people really thrive in doing, and this can be very helpful for them. And this is actually good, because this actually improves our daily activities and even improves our skills, because it is stress that helps us to do better. So, but what can be really detrimental is that when stress is prolonged, when there is chronic stress, wherein we are constantly vigilant, in high vigilance mode for prolonged periods, where there is really no time for your brain, no breaks for your brain to rest and recover. Because what happens when we are stressed is that our body releases a hormone called cortisol. So cortisol is a stress hormone that is released when we are stressed. So it is associated really also with a lot of diseases. If our cortisol level is constantly high. So what do we do is that we try to reduce our stress, because what happens is persistently high levels of cortisol may destroy the cells in our brain, and the part of the brain called the hippocampus. This is like the emotional part of our brain, where this is responsible for memory too, and helping with stress. So in the recent years, in the last few decades, there has been really a field in medicine called psychoneuroimmunology, and there is even like a psychoendoneuroimmunology. So they really look at how chronic stress affects the immune system. They are realizing that this high vigilance states, where we are constantly on excessive cortisol, really affects the brain and really lowers our immune system. So it is really important that we talk about stress, not the positive kind of stress, but what can we do to pull back stress reduce stress to a lower level where we can use it to be able to do things that are beneficial for us. So one of those things that we have seen over the years that can be helpful is really to develop resilience. So what is resilience? Resilience is our capacity to recover or adjust from difficulties. So if there are difficult situations in life, it's really the muscle that we need to build to be able to overcome those. So what happens is that how we see things or our perceptions and our responses to stressors are really going to change how we react and the outcomes of our experience. So there is a psychologist who has spent decades, I think 30 years even of research, 20, 30 years of research. His name is Dr. Martin Seligman. And over the years of studying resilience, he has found that there are three things that can really affect how we see hardship. So the three things are personalization, pervasiveness, and permanence. So what is personalization? So personalization is this internalization of failure. So we look at things as this is my fault. I was diagnosed with Parkinson's. This must be my fault. I must have done something wrong. And we internalize that failure. But the reality is not everything that happens to us is really because of us. You know, studies have shown that if we, you know, get past personalization, if we do not take things personally, that this event that occurred is because of us, then we are able to bounce back better. Then it becomes easier for us and we can actually become stronger. Another thing is pervasiveness. So this is the belief that one setback will spread to all aspects of life. Here, everything is just awful. I was diagnosed with Parkinson's. Therefore, all my plans are already ruined. I cannot have anything good. So everything, it becomes all-consuming. So what we see actually is that the reality is things actually will get better. It gradually becomes clear that not all areas in our life will really be affected by one thing. We may have Parkinson's, but that we still have our family. We still have things that we enjoy doing or can develop to enjoy doing, and we can develop those stuff. So the thought that it is just really one aspect can help us move on and do better and maybe embark on new things. So another thing that can affect when difficult situations arise is this permanence. So this is the belief that this feeling will last forever. We often sometimes project our feelings out indefinitely. Like if we feel anxious, like, you're just going to be forever anxious. Then sometimes we're anxious because we're anxious, or we feel sad because we are feeling sad. So it just spirals down. But the reality is with Parkinson's, you will realize that it's not going to last forever. You may have a bad day today, but that doesn't mean that's going to be every day. There are going to be good days, but there are going to be bad days, but there are also going to be good days. So it's sort of like a roller coaster ride, really. And I think the important thing is to focus on making those good days even better and to reduce those bad days. So if we can change how we see this thing and respond to these feelings, to accept these feelings, if you are feeling sad right now, it's really okay to be sad, to accept them, but also know that this isn't going to stay there forever. So how do we do that? What are the things that we can do? I'm just checking my time. What are the things that we can do to reduce our stress? We highly, really recommend meditation and mindfulness. I'm sure you've heard versions of this, and there are really so many things within relation to meditation and mindfulness. There are so many apps that you can try. Though some of them I've already mentioned earlier for sleep, they also do have meditation or mindfulness apps. Calm is another one I mentioned already. Like I said, Insight Timer, Headspace. Those are some of those that I can think on top of my head right now. But this is really a very important practice to cultivate. I really like this quote from John Zabotzin, so I included it here. And it says that the awareness, mindfulness and meditation is the awareness that arises by paying attention in a particular way, on purpose, in the moment, and non-judgmentally. Again, on purpose, in the moment, and non-judgmentally. You know, these are very simple practices. They're simple, but not easy, I like to say. It's really important that you find a space for you to sit and then sit in a place of quiet to practice this every day, and maybe try one of those apps if you can. But a really simple way I can probably share with you that I really like is breath work, because you just sit down, take deep breaths, maybe count 4 seconds in, hold your breath, and then 4 seconds out. So what this does is that with this deep breathing, so you do this repeatedly. You probably do it, do sets of 10. If you can do 3 sets of 10 of this breathing in for 4 seconds, holding your breath if you can, and then releasing for another 4 seconds. You can just count in your mind. And I think these are really good practices to develop, because if you practice this every day, it's already training your mind. It's training your mind to relax, to reduce stress. What happens when we are stressed is that our sympathetic nervous system, this is our fight or flight, kicks in. So we become, our heart may be racing. When we are stressed, we may even feel it in our body. So when we feel that our stress, our level of stress is also in that level, that it's really not helpful for you anymore. So it's really important to bring that level of stress down. And that is why this meditation and mindfulness is very important, because this really puts the brake on your sympathetic nervous system and activates your parasympathetic nervous system, which is your rest and digest. So by doing that, you can do that by doing this exercises. So why I repeatedly said to make a practice of doing this, and by that I mean trying to do it daily, not trying, doing it daily. And that is because if you do it daily, it becomes automatic for your brain. Our brain likes everything to be automatic so that it doesn't have to use so much energy. If we only pull this or do this when we're already stressed, it may be a little more difficult to reduce your stress. But if you do this every day and make it a practice, then when you are experiencing moments of stress, then you can pull out this in your toolbox, pull these practices out of your toolbox and help dial your stress down. So that is really important to note, to really try to make this a practice. Like I said, it doesn't have to be breathing exercises. There are so many meditation apps, videos, books that you can do. I'm trying to think of her name, but I'll think of her name later. But there are definitely a lot of books that you can look into this. There are free video YouTube videos that you can also check out. So another thing that you can also do is progressive muscle relaxation. So this progressive muscle relaxation, or PMR, is it's really a practice to reduce muscle tension and promote relaxation. So I don't know if you've noticed that when you're stressed or certain muscles in your body are really tense, some of us carry that in your neck or your low upper back. Some of us may experience it in our face, where we're maybe clenching our teeth, or there's a tightness in our jaw. So this practice really helps with that. I don't think we have a lot of time, so I'm gonna just demonstrate this, not demonstrate, but I'm gonna give you a little more idea on how to do it. So PMR is when you physically relax, tense up a part of your body during inhalation, and then relax it during exhalation. So there, like I said, there are videos of doing this, but the key is at the end of doing this, it can really reduce your stress level. So a good video that I have found to be helpful is when you do progressive muscle relaxation from your toes. So you curl your toes, clench your toes, this is your toes, take deep breaths, hold it for a few seconds, and then release. And then after you release that, maybe you can try your foot, where you flex your foot forward, tense it, clench it, and then relax. And then maybe flex your foot towards you, that you will feel a tension in your upper thigh when you do that. Hold that for a few seconds, and then release. And then you can just go up. You can even do it until your face, where you tighten your face and then relax. So there are definitely a lot of videos that you can find online doing this. But doing this is another way for you to help relax and reduce your stress. Another thing is biofeedback. So biofeedback is really a technology that gives you feedback about your biological signals. So this can tell you if this can detect either an increase in your heart rate, maybe an increase in temperature, or muscle tension. So you usually may need help with this. There are a lot of therapists that do this. So they do have electrodes that they put to measure this. However, a more practical, or if you don't want to see a therapist, if I feel like just being mindful of your body, when you are feeling stressed, you will feel parts of your body that changes. It may be that heart racing, you may feel your heart rate beat a little faster. Some of you may feel like maybe a tingling in their hands, or your hands are all of a sudden feeling cold, or there is tension in your upper back. So those are good indicators too. So you can use your body, if you're attuned with it, to see, okay, I believe I'm feeling stressed right now because I really feel my hands are a little clammy, or I feel my heart racing. And maybe then you can do your breathing technique to help lower your stress. So those are some of the ways. Another thing is mindful movement. I like this because this is something that you can do at any time as well. This can be in a form of exercise. Some people do yoga or tai chi because these are repetitive movements that are slow, that you are just focused on what you are doing. You know what I find too, that is kind of mindful movement, is actually doing your laundry. When you're folding your clothes, it's something that's really repetitive, but then it's sort of mindless. You're just focused on the folding. So it doesn't have to be that, but activities like that where it's repetitive can actually help reduce your stress. So another part of the recommendations is really interaction with others, interact with others. So this is a little controversial because of COVID right now, but social isolation and loneliness can create can increase the risk of developing cognitive impairment. So it's really important that we stay in touch with family members or loved ones or significant others or friends. I know this is challenging with COVID. You know, in the past 10 months, it is important that we are safe. However, we've also really, at least in our practice, have seen an increase in cognitive impairment in patients just by the isolation alone. So with COVID in this pandemic, we need to be really a little more creative, and we may even need really help of family or friends. But it is really important to, you may be not physically together with your loved ones, but it's really important that we put in the effort to connect with others. And this can be done through Zoom and other activities. So you can, a lot of, over the last 10 months, probably most of you, if not all of you, have had like digital get-togethers with your family and friends. You can participate in groups or clubs. A lot of the groups, there are support groups that have moved in through Zoom or digitally. So you can connect with those groups. Or if you already have like a group of friends, you can maybe plan activities together. Become a volunteer is another thing. So it's interesting because I actually Googled it, and just to see if there are volunteer work but there are actually a lot that you can do digitally. So that is one of those things that you can do. Take group classes. There are exercise groups that, and you know, it's good to double down on like things that you can do. Maybe volunteering for classes. There are other classes too. The Emeritus College have free classes. UCLA Extension, I think I think you pay for those. But there are definitely classes. If there are things that you feel like you're curious about, you don't necessarily have to be great at them. But if you participate, you're also learning something new, which is really important as well. So maintaining family relationships, scheduling fun activities with your loved ones. Even if you're doing it through Zoom, maybe you can like maybe schedule dinner together where you're at least eating together and you're able to talk. Or maybe you can do cooking together, even if it's just you're separated and just do it online. Pets are also nice to have. A lot of people like to have pets because it's really a good companion for you. It's something that you can take care of, and it's something that also reciprocates usually our affection. So it's really great to have pets. It's very therapeutic for us cognitively and psychologically as well. Exercise. So exercise, I want to, before we make like recommendations that are specific, a little more specific, I want you to consider a few things. So one of the things to really consider is your activity level. When you're starting, if you are someone who has exercised all your life, has always been active, you know, then you can add more activities maybe, and you can, that challenges you. But if you're also someone who has been quite sedentary, not really active, definitely you can start small. I always tell patients, I would rather you do something for 5 minutes. If that's everything that you can give, start with 5 minutes versus not doing anything at all. So we do recommend like a more moderate intensity. However, if you're just starting, anything, any small activity is a good start. That is still better than nothing. So really consider where your current activity level is. Also consider what is it that you enjoy doing, and if what you enjoy, you don't really enjoy the traditional exercises, but you enjoy dancing, then that's a really good thing to explore and do. You can even do it with your family, so that can be a social event as well. If you enjoy going for hikes, you can do that. And make sure that what you are doing is sustainable too. I don't want you to all of a sudden decide today, I'm gonna start exercise today, and you do high intensity workout and then be so tired that you forget it altogether. So I want you to do it really in a sustainable way. Do it in a little increments where you're slowly improving, you're pushing yourself, but you also are not jumping in too high where you just completely just abandon it. So it's also good to combine exercise with nature. So this is a good way to maybe go out if you like to enjoy hikes. You can go out, or some people, they do like yoga or tai chi outside in a park. Of course, this is a time of COVID, so make sure you're socially distanced when you do this. So acquiring new skills while exercising, you try to do other exercises. Maybe you're someone who just really like walking. Maybe you can incorporate now weight exercises, or try to do boxing. That's something new. It's something that combines different forms of exercises, because you're focusing on your hands and your form. So that is really combining several skills. If you're not really a dancer, maybe this is something that you would want to explore doing too. So like I said, we can incorporate several forms of exercises. So what are the different exercises that we do? So cardiovascular exercises are what we call aerobic training or aerobic exercises. So these are general recommendations. I don't want you to think of this as this is the only thing that is the right thing to do. Like I said, if you're a beginner, you don't have to do 30 minutes, but at least start something. If you can devote 5 minutes, I'll take it. But for those that are already exercising, if you can do 30 minutes of cardiovascular exercises, these are moderate intensity exercises, at least 5 days a week, then by all means do so. This includes brisk walking, cycling, swimming, elliptical, treadmill. So very important, please make sure to ask your cardiologist or your internist prior to doing high intensity regimen, just to be sure that your heart is healthy to do this exercises. So resistance training, so this is for strengthening. You know, actually in the clinical trials, it is really resistance training that has been specific to help Parkinson's patients. So in the clinical trials, it actually showed that it can slow down the progression of the disease. So in terms of exercises, we really, if you can, really do resistance training. There is no pill right now that can really stop or cure Parkinson's at this point, but this can at least slow down the progression of the disease. And I think that's really important. So we recommend doing it twice a week. This exercises, you can use it either using resistance bands, weights. If you have resistance machines, medicine balls, you can do it. You can do it with body weight as well. You can do repetitions, different sets, maybe 3 sets is what we're recommending. But like I said, this isn't written in stone. These are recommendations, but see where your level is and then start from there. But definitely incorporate it. So you can gradually increase your resistance and do more repetitions as you get better and feel comfortable doing this as the weeks go by. So another form is neuromotor training. This is really neurocognitive training or dual tasking. So this is recommended to do at least twice a week. Here you maintain a physical function that includes a motor skill like balance, coordination, gait, and agility exercises. So these are really fun exercises too, because you're stimulating your brain different ways too. Like with dance or tai chi or yoga, what you're doing is that you're trying to focus while maintaining balance too. So there's the different aspect of it as well. So this is really good training. So this is recommended twice per week. flexibility is your stretching. Do stretches before and after exercises. This will really warm up your muscles too. So you can actually do a combination of these exercises. So for those of you that are already doing, have an exercise regimen, you can look back at this and see what you can incorporate or maybe add to what you are already doing. So you can combine this too. Let's say you're doing 30 minutes of aerobic exercise and maybe you can add another 30 minutes of your resistance training. So that's an hour. So when you do that, you can actually just work out like a couple of days a week versus the 5 days if you combine exercises. So this is just a good illustration. I actually borrowed this slide from Ryan Glapp and I wasn't able to put his name on it, but I did ask his permission. So he made this illustration and it's a really good illustration of doing a combination of exercises because these different exercises actually stimulates different parts of our brain. So it's a really good picture that tells us when we're doing one exercise versus the other. So it's a really good picture. So another thing, another part of our SHIELD recommendation is learning new things. And this is really prioritizing mental activities that support learning. It be recommended to learn something new at least 4 hours a day. So that's really brain training. It keeps us young. When we're learning new things, it really helps stimulate the brain. So it could be a number of things. It could be as simple as maybe you're instead of asking your children or your spouse to like learn how to use Zoom, maybe that's something that you can learn so that the next time you can communicate with others or outside your family too, or learn a new hobby. So these are examples of healthy brain stimulation activities like taking a class, learning to use new technology. Like I said, maybe you can learn to use Zoom, or if you have a smartphone, downloading apps, just simply learning to do those things is going to be really helpful for you. Gardening is something that can be fun too. It's good to be working with your hands. Learning a food recipe, you can do this with like a friend, maybe playing games. There are games that are really good for cognitive health too. Luminosity is one of them. We do recommend like Sudoku as well, but there are also like card games, like memory games using cards. That can be helpful as well. Playing a musical instrument or learning to play a musical instrument, you can learn to play like as simple as maybe I'll learn to play a birthday song so that when it's someone's birthday, you can just play the piano or a guitar of just a happy birthday song. Something like that, something you can use. Arts and crafts is also another good way. If you enjoy drawing, that's one of them too. Reading and writing is also a good way of learning. There are a lot of not just nonfiction, not just fiction books, but there are a lot of books that you can that can help you learn something new. Writing is also a good way. Maybe you can ask one of your children to help you, like start a blog or something, and then try something new. Trip planning and travel as well. So that involves really a lot of like research and coordination of things. So that can be something that's really helpful. I'm going to go really quickly. I'm already low in time. So last thing on the SHIELD protocol is diet. Very important thing. Our goal here at the Movement Disorder Center is to really optimize our brain function. So we do recommend mind diet or brain healthy diet. And this essentially is a low carbohydrate diet. So we would like for you to consider avoiding sugar and instead incorporate more food that can boost cognition. And a lot of them are really vegetables, fatty fish, berries and nuts too. So food that are that we highly recommend, green leafy vegetables, such as your kale, spinach, drink a lot of water. Water, in general, 8 cups of water. Obviously, if you do have cardiac history or cardiac disease, make sure that you consult your doctor because your water intake may be limited. So these are general recommendations. And like I said, look at it and see what you can add or maybe change a little bit to add to what you are already doing. So these recommendations are recommendations. And I want you to look at it as these are foods that you can incorporate that can increase brain function. This is not, I do not want you to look at this as, oh, I can't eat something or something restrictive. Instead, look at it as, what is it that I can do to increase my brain function? Maybe eating more of this will help me. So if you don't necessarily have to stop eating sugar, I mean, if you can, then that would be great, but it might be unrealistic for us to ask you that. But if you can reduce them and do more of the good stuff, more of the whole foods like fruits, especially fruits like berries, then that will be more beneficial for you. I have here protein, and I can already see the questions with protein with regards to those of you that may be taking carbidopa levodopa. You can have protein with carbidopa levodopa, but you have to time it where you are taking it 30 minutes. So you avoid food or protein 30 minutes before taking your medication or an hour after. Just because protein interacts with the carbidopa levodopa, so making the efficacy a little lower. So, but if you're really hungry, go ahead and eat. But if in general, as a general rule, try to avoid protein 30 minutes before a meal or an hour after or before your carbidopa levodopa. So fish 3 times a week, choose organic products because they're free of pesticides, hormones, and antibiotics. So food to avoid, red meat, if you can limit those, sugar, like we've already said, avoid alcohol as well. So alcohol is tricky. If you look at the Mediterranean diet, you can have wine, but I say limit it, especially with the Parkinson's, where there is also problems with balance and falls. So be very discriminating with your alcohol. Minimize processed food and avoid fried food and charred food. I did not include dairy in it because it's already, it's controversial enough, but milk can cause a lot of inflammation. So that's why we want to reduce it a little bit. Although sour dairy like yogurt is really beneficial. So that's it. I am so sorry. I think I have like 2 minutes of time left. It's a really long presentation. So, but thank you everyone. Let me stop share. Okay. I'm sorry, that was really long.
Thank you, Giselle. That was lovely. I don't see any questions from the audience, which is very surprising. So I don't know if anybody's having trouble entering questions in. I see 2 people with hands raised, but we are not able to, we're in the interest of confidentiality, we're not, opening people's videos or audio. So if somebody has their hand raised, please put your question in the question and answer panel in the next minute. I think that, there's a question about times before and after as far as protein intake on carbidopa levodopa.
So it's really take your carbidopa levodopa 30 minutes before meal or an hour after as our usual recommendation. But like Dr. Petrosian said in the last webinar, you know, it's really important that you take your meds. We do recommend that you take it 30 minutes, you take your medication 30 minutes before or an hour after meal. However, it's really important that you take your medication. So if you've already eaten, just go ahead and eat. It is more important that you take your medication. I reversed it earlier. I'm so sorry. Thank you, John. Thank you for letting me know. Supplements, you know, we don't really recommend supplements. We always get a lot of questions with regards to supplements. There's really not a lot of like strong evidence that supplements are helpful. And a lot of them are really not FDA approved. So we really do not recommend them this time. There's really not one that has been shown to really benefit Parkinson. Fermented foods be avoided? Should fermented foods be avoided? I think if you're taking restagiline, then you may limit. So as a general rule, you don't really need to, unless you're eating like a ton of it, then that becomes an issue. But if you're like a normal person eating, then you should be able to eat your fermented foods. But like I said, if you're eating like a lot, then just be mindful too. Just regular amounts, you're fine. There are really studies even that can, that saying that fermented foods are good for your gut. So it can help, may be helpful, but just be mindful of the amount, is that what I would say. I think that's it.
Giselle, there's a question about when we say that exercise slows down the progression of Parkinson's, how is that measured?
So there was really a clinical trial that was done a few years. This is probably like a decade ago already. And what they did was they had like a big group actually of Parkinson's patients, about 1,200, and half of them, they did like regular cardiovascular exercises, and the other half did resistance training, and they followed this patient in for 2 years, and they have found that although there was improvement in general health in both groups, but the one that did the resistance training, there was actually really a slowing down of the progression of the disease. And this was measured by, if you see us in clinic, you know that we do what we call a UPDRS. It's a rating scale that we do for measuring the progression of motor symptoms. So they were able to measure that through the UPDRS.
I think that was really great. I think we're after our time, a lot of time. So I want to really thank you, Giselle. I want to thank all of our participants who've joined us today and asked excellent questions. And we look forward to hearing from Sheila next month, March 1st. She'll be discussing in more detail how to combat isolation, how to increase engagement and support groups that are available. Thank you all. Take care.
Thank you so much.